He will be late. He will be in at night.
Mr. Cole?
Here.
Can we speak up, please?
Present.
Mayor Holliday?
Present.
Mr. Hoffmeister?
Here.
Ms. Miller?
Here.
Mr. Menon?
Absent.
Two absent and present.
Thank you. Could we stand and say the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Mayor Holliday.
Before we start public comment, I just wanted to say that I appreciate all of you being here today. I know this was a very difficult budget. We spent all day going over the budget again and again, looking, you know, for any additional savings. We had one revenue projection that was very conservative. We can bump that up a little bit, and with a few other cuts in the city budget, I will fund that second grade teacher so we can keep that position.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you very much.
And now, why don't we start public comment?
I'm sure there is no public comment now. Now, this is a session of public comment. If you would like to make a comment to this committee, could you please step forward and state your name and your address? And I'd ask you to come in front of the camera so we can capture that. Is there any public comment at this time? Yes.
Am I going on the other side of the...
I don't think I need a microphone. My name is Mary Ellen Hoyseth. I am a second grade teacher at the Bresnahan School. I have been in the system teaching for 23 years. I graduated from the Newburyport schools. Both my daughters graduated from the Newburyport schools. My mom even graduated from the Newburyport schools when they reopened this high school the first time around. So I'm very invested in the community. I live in Newburyport as well. My address is 10 Virginia Lane. Very happy to hear about the second grade, but I still feel there are some things that need to be said. I've had the pleasure of having some of the folks in the audience having their children in school, Ms. Miller's child as well, and many others. And I think a big part of what we do is hands-on learning and bringing things to life. And I know that happens across the school system, but for the little ones especially, it really is an equalizer. We have a lot of children with a variety of needs in our system. Not everybody reads at the same time. Not everybody understands math at the same time. And I think when we are given that freedom to integrate the curriculum and to talk about things in a way that that child that maybe doesn't connect from the reading point can connect in a hands-on way by building a model of something or by learning a song, or there's so many different ways. But when we see class sizes continue to go up and up and up, that truly does become impossible. When I stepped back to first grade last year, I had 22 students. That's very large in first grade class. When I can look back and say I've had 17, I've had 18. This year, I have 22 students in second grade, and had we not looked at this, restoring this cut, that would have been even bigger next year. I really hope that we can take a look at class size guidelines, think about what kind of learning we're doing. I personally have done a lot of things with STEM this year. I've been very blessed. I have a son-in-law that's a scientist. I have a parent in my classroom who is an astrophysics professor. So I've had some resources, but not everyone has those resources. I might not have them again next year. So we have to allow the numbers to stay at a level where students can have those experiences, where teachers can pull those five children that are struggling with math in the morning and be able to manage the rest of the group. We can't overload the classrooms. We can't start taking away arts. There's just, we've been really blessed to get a beautiful new school at the Bresnahan. And, but a beautiful new building isn't what's gonna teach the kids. Mm-hmm. It's going to be the classroom teachers, the special ed teachers, the special subject teachers, and we're all dedicated. I personally stay many nights late and I have plenty of cars in the parking lot with me, but people, I really hope, can look at class size and look at what we want our kids to be able to do and think long and hard about maybe making a stronger commitment to this not always being on the edge of the cliff and then we pull back. I think we need to look at where do we want to be in 5 years and 10 years and how are we going to manage positions and funding and other things so that we can get there and stay there without so much trepidation all the time. So thank you, and thank you for putting that position back. I think that's really a morale booster and makes us all feel a little better. So thank you.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Renee Ames at 17 Forester Street. I spoke last week in several other meetings in the past, and I just want to say thank you for restoring that cut. I want to echo what Mary Ellen said, that class size is a huge impact on classroom teachers, and more importantly, it has a huge impact on the experience that kids have in our classrooms. Our population, this has been said before, but our student population is more diverse than people might guess. Our kids in need, there's more of them than people might understand. And when you have too many kids concentrated into too few sections, the number of needs goes up, and therefore the teacher's ability to get to everybody is decreased. So I really am so incredibly appreciative that cut was reconsidered. And that's for the kids at that class, in that particular class. Also for my children, I'm worried about them and what will happen to them as they go through our school. And I just want to echo the comments that Mary Ellen made, that I would love for us to keep in the forefront what impacts kids the most. And class size is one of the things that can positively impact a kid's experience in our schools. So thank you. Heartfelt thank you.
You're welcome.
Yes.
Hi, I'm Elizabeth Goulou. I also spoke last week, G-O-U-L-L-A-U-D. I live at 9 Marquand Lane in Newburyport. Last week I was only able to be here after a last minute change, so I didn't have anything prepared, so I'll also be unable to attend the city council meeting next week because I have to work. So I felt it was important to be here tonight with prepared remarks. My husband and I moved to Newburyport about 6 years ago. One of the main considerations we looked into when choosing Newburyport was the school system, as many people do when looking to buy a house. In fact, a good school system is one of the main correlations to property values and what cities or towns are considered to be the best places to live. Because of this, having an excellent school system benefits everyone in the city. Whether or not you have school-age children, whether or not you have children at all, whether or not you consider education to be as important as I do or important at all, it benefits everybody. There are many concerns I have about the budget as it is, even with the second grade position put back in, even after we were told last week that there was no money anywhere. Now there's money. But even with that back in, I still have many concerns about the budget and some of the things that were said at the last school committee meeting. Class size was discussed quite a bit. Then it was made clear after the public comment that they probably wouldn't be changing very much. My desire, though, is not to see that our schools simply don't become worse, but to see that they improve. Ideal class size in the elementary grades is more like 18, so we're nowhere near that. In addition, there are many things that were removed from the schools over the past decade that have been yet to be returned. For one example, the foreign language program in the middle school that was mentioned last week. I've been hearing about this since I moved here. And there is still no foreign language program in the middle school and only two languages at the high school. When I was in high school in the mid-80s, in a city, not in some fancy school, I had five languages to choose from. As I mentioned last week, I realized that I am not easily pleased when it comes to excellence in education, so I want to be very clear. I won't be satisfied with foreign languages being added back into the middle school curriculum. Foreign language should be introduced in kindergarten. As far as I'm concerned, this budget is a step backward, not just a continuation of the status quo, because we're falling behind, not just in foreign language education, but in the arts, in STEM, in many other ways. The status quo isn't even quite what this budget allows for, and we continue to fall further and further behind. This brings me to one of my biggest concerns, which is the constant repetition about how the budget, and therefore money allocated to the schools by this city, has been increasing over the past, 7 years. I'm astonished and blown away that this fact would be considered surprising in any way. The cost of things increases. Next year, if the budget doesn't ask for a single additional thing, I would assume there'll be an increase in cost. I can't even fathom why anyone would be unprepared for that. I believe I made my position clear last week, but I will reiterate. I am watching closely to see whether or not I believe my elected representatives consider education to be a top priority. And I will be voting against and actively campaigning against any and all who don't. I don't intend for this to come off in an aggressive or intimidating manner. I just want to be clear about my intentions going forward. I want to have people with the same priorities as mine representing me, so that I don't feel like I need to attend every city meeting to represent myself and my interests. If the majority of people in the city do not have the same priorities as I do, then so be it. But I would be remiss if I didn't adequately work to have my interests represented by those who I elect to represent me. Lastly, the mayor stated last week that there is no money, that there are many city departments operating on a shoestring budget, specifically alluding to our fire and police departments being underfunded. When determining tax rate for the city, it cannot increase beyond 2.5 due to the tax cap passed by voters in 1980. If you look at the cities and towns with the best school systems in the Commonwealth, you will notice that they have sought and received overrides to that cap to put additional funds into the municipal operating budget many, many times, most of them. Yet not only has an override not been requested, but taxes weren't even raised to the 2.5% allowed by state law. This tells me we have plenty of money. Why wouldn't we go to 2.5% if we didn't have enough money? So I'm baffled. I'm completely baffled as to how one can state that schools and education is a priority, state that there isn't enough money to fund them properly, state that we don't have the money to properly fund police and firefighters, and yet still not choose to use the most taxes that we are allowed by state law, which is a very low percentage increase. We cannot choose to continue to do this without continuing to see cuts. I also recall last year's budget presentation, freshman sports were cut, there was an uproar, and within maybe a week, there was money for freshman sports. Apparently the same thing happened this year too. I'm not sure where that money came from, nor do I really care where it specifically came from, but it makes me consider that when we have no more money, that I don't really know what that means. Are we adequately accessing all potential revenue? I don't think so. Certainly, we are not accessing all potential property tax revenue, so all I can ascertain from that is that many of my elected officials have very different priorities than I do. I realize it takes political courage to raise taxes, and I know we just invested a lot of money into our infrastructure. However, education is the service that is provided inside those buildings. If we don't adequately fund that, then the building has done nothing more than put extra money into some construction company's pocket. I know compromise is an important part of politics, but there comes a time when you've compromised so much that you've lost sight of the initial goal. I think the time for compromise has ended. I am looking for courage, and I am still asking that you reject this budget. Thank you. Thank you.
Further public comment? Yes. Yes.
Ralph Orlando, 4 William Hall Drive. I'm going to take this opportunity to speak for myself, as I will be speaking as part of the Newburyport High School School Council, and I would hope, I don't see it listed here, that that is an item on the agenda that will be welcomed by the committee. I'd have to say that, yes, I'm very thankful for the addition of a second grade teacher, but I would agree with the woman who spoke before me. This budget is sad to shameful, because it's the same thing we've done year after year. So I'm talking to school committee now, because that's what this is a forum for. I'm not here to talk to all the teachers that are here. You cannot continually come to the 11th hour with the strategic cuts that you think you have to make the budget work. You've all heard me before. I've not been here this year because I was disenfranchised from this group, because I don't feel you're as transparent as you were before, and you're not as open to public comment or public conversation as you may have been in administrations prior. There's only one person in this room right now who can attest to what I'm talking about, and that's Mr. Cole, because he goes back to 2006, along with me. So the process is flawed, and you've heard this before, and I am going to be brief. You must start much earlier. And in starting earlier, there are two things I would encourage you to do. The first is you have to look at not what was budgeted the year before, because that's all we ever do, is we start with the budgeted amounts, we add a certain 3%, and then we come in with the ask. So you need to look at what your actual expenses were, and I don't think that's ever been done. Second thing is, you can't constantly continue to add money to a citizen group that wants you to look at where are their avenues to be saved. I've never heard conversations in this room, 10 years that I've come here, about how we save money with the budget we already have. You need to look at administration, you need to look at transportation, you need to look at meals. Because all we ever end up doing here is something that adversely affects the student and student learning. Whether it's a continued loss of teachers or what have you, all it does is continue to deteriorate the school system. And we all know, because some of us have been here many years, this is not the district it was 10 years ago. And I've educated every one of my kids in this school district. And my two older boys, one who's graduated college last year, one this year, did not receive the education of my daughter. And I'm not here bashing teachers, as I've been accused in the past. But it takes courage. And that's what I think these people want you to do. Take the courage to take a look. Discuss where the savings are. You need to take a look at that. It's very difficult. We don't have to bus every student that we bus here in this district. And parents who think they pay for it, you don't touch it in terms of what you pay for it. Many school districts don't provide transportation to students. May not like that, but at the expense of teachers, I'm not so sure. Have the conversation, have the courage to talk about it. Do we have the right number of administrators? Do we have to feed people in our schools to make some profit? So what I'm asking you to do is, because I'm not coming back, and you're probably all very glad of that, but please take a look not only at what you're asking, but take a look at your process and see what you can do to make the process better. Thank you for your time, and I will speak to you later as part of the high school council, where I have remained very engaged and know all the facts. Thank you.
Sorry, it's hard to get up here.
That's okay, I'm just standing in front of the camera. My name is Kathy Mashburn, M-A-S-H-B-U-R-N. I was here last week speaking to all of you. A little bit of the wind has been taken out of my sail, because that position has been put back in. But I agree with what everybody else is saying, and that we have to plan forward. I didn't even think of the bus situation, and that's a very good point. Maybe we all pay for the bus. I'm one of those lucky ones that lives 2 miles outside of the school. I pay to put my kids on the bus. That would be fine. That's okay. If that's going to save a teacher's job, if that's going to give the kids more of what they need, then that's fine. The special education line item is very large, was talked about a few times. It's going to get bigger if we continue or think about making our classrooms bigger. Some of the things that, as a substitute a lot at the Bresnahan School, some of the things that I see on a regular basis as the job of a teacher is educator, counselor, nurse, mediator, negotiator, generator of grant requests, classroom management, curriculum, creating curriculums, and sadly, but true, surrogate parents. Not anything bad about the parents, but there are some that can't do it, some that don't have the time to do it, and those teachers take on that role. And that needs to be looked at as well, what these teachers are going through on a day-to-day basis when we're looking at potentially making their classrooms bigger. Is that fair to them? It's certainly not fair to the students. So again, thank you for your time. I appreciate it, and I think my last remark would be that in September, when the teacher's contract comes up for renegotiation, I hope they get the 3% that the superintendent and the assistant superintendent are getting, because they definitely deserve it.
Sean Flaherty, I live at 3 Summit Place. I've taught in the district for almost 20 years. And like what Dr. Orlando just said, you know, I have older children. The education that they receive, I see as a better one than that are offered to the students in our schools today. I thank people in our community who voted for the debt exclusions for the beautiful new Bresnahan School, the renovated middle Mullen School, the fields. And it was said eloquently here by a parent this evening and also by a teacher last week. We have a beautiful infrastructure and we're taking away. You know, when you look at a level service budget, that's less money than what was spent the year before. So again, I'm asking the school committee to vote no on this proposed budget. Thank you.
My name is Lauren Aramo. I'm at 49 Kent Street. I'm a resident. I'm a parent of a freshman. And I'm a fifth grade teacher at the Mullen. I've also had the experience of being bounced between grades when the student numbers fluctuate. And I would suggest that this is a short-sighted and detrimental way of balancing the budget on the backs of students. And with all due respect to all the parents who have very nicely spoken about all the teachers having to go into their own pockets for supplies, this is not really the problem. I have enough supplies. The parents in Newburyport are more than willing to send in pencils and notebooks and folders. It is not a stuff problem that we have, it's a people problem that we have. We don't have enough people in our classrooms right now. We don't have enough support in our classrooms. And we can't get that out of our pockets. In our current model, because of the resources and lack of resources, we have our special education teachers co-teaching with a general educator. And in these classrooms, 2 in the 4th and 2 in the 5th, one of which I'm attached to, the students' needs are met. I have a general educator, I have a special educator, and I have an assistant in my room. And I have many IEPs and many kids who don't have IEPs who need that support anyways. So my room is well supported. But the problem with this model is it doesn't effectively support any student that's identified after September in another classroom, because the special educators in my classroom are fully extended, overextended, and they do their best to help with any new thing that comes up, but they're full out all day already. So with no reading or math interventionist in the fourth grade, we're seeing fifth graders, by the time they get to fifth grade, they're being identified as needing extra support because after getting it at the Bresnahan, they didn't get it in the fourth grade. Everybody knows the fourth grade transition is tough, and there's no extra support for them when they get there. So we can't afford to lose any bodies at the Mullen, and really anywhere at this point, but I would suggest that a community like Newburyport should not be thinking about where we can move a teacher because we don't have enough money. We have a tax base that is able to support more, and we need to ask for more at the extent that we can, because we can do that, and to not do that is a mistake. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Debbie Savo. I live at 14 Atwood Street, Newburyport. I have a son who went through the system. I wasn't planning to say anything. I was just sort of here to support everybody. But I do want to just toss out this idea that when someone just read that whole litany of jobs that teachers do now, I've been teaching for, a really long time. over 30 years here, and I taught before I came here in Boston. And the job is just not the same. I realize that money is still money, and money is the same. But I can tell you really, and I totally applaud everyone who does what they do in the elementary school and the middle school, but the problem of keeping class size small and keeping a strong staff is just as true in the high school, where we have more students having concussions, we have more students on medications, changing their medications. I don't mean self-medicating, although we have those too, but you know, all of those needs of students are so much greater than they were 10 years ago, as people have commented, or 20 years ago, and it's really having a fewer number of students just enables us to give more. As you know, teachers sort of give endlessly. I think we're all probably neurotic givers, but but at the end of the day, we're finite human beings, and so even when we give all we can, having fewer students really helps.
Anyone else?
My name is Tom O'Brien. I live at 11 Mosley Ave. I'm the Ward 6 Council and City Council President. I came here tonight, fire and brimstone, to protect the requested job of a person who's going to get laid off. My grandson has had the pleasure of having this lady as a teacher, and if you didn't restore that position, the future kids of Newburyport that would have had the chance to have her as a teacher, it would be lost. It's a great thing to have her back. I mean, she's a great thing for the school and for the city and for the future of Newburyport kids that will have her in her classes. So thank you for putting it back. Also, I'd like to say that the city council, when the budget comes for the city council, we cannot add. We can only recommend cuts. And if we recommend cuts to the school department, the school committee and the school department, they decide where the cuts go and where to add and whatever. But, you know, in years past, you know, I've been 18 years as a city councilor, and I've seen many budgets that things had to be done. And some of the things that were done were done by the rest of the employees in Newburyport. They decided not to take a pay raise at a certain time to get a 0%. So other people couldn't be laid off. You know, the meeting before this, we talked about all the positions that you want to add and everything. You know, maybe, you know, just for 1 year, if it's time, you know, teachers want to get 3% for whatever, you know. I know you want to get as much as you can, but, you know, like I said, other times people took 0%. Maybe if the teachers took 0.5 or whatever, we could add some of these programs back in and add some more teachers and more programs, get the Spanish teachers back, get the guidance, get everything back. You know, maybe it's time to do that, because, like I said, it was done in the past from the city side, so maybe just, I don't know how much money, you know, not just the teachers, but the administrators. You know, when we get a 3-4% raise on top of a large salary, that's a large chunk of money, so, you know. And if you just bite the bullet for a year, and hopefully we can do something better and help with the budget for next year. But if we just, everyone take a little cut and, you know, don't take the full 1% or whatever the contract you're talking about now, might be helpful to save many, many programs and add programs in the future. So that's all I have to say. Thank you very much.
Anyone else?
My name is Ann Miles. I'm 10 Marquand Lane. I am an educator. I'm a reading specialist in the Wakefield Public Schools. I'm also a parent. I have 3 kids in the Newburyport schools, 5th grade, 4th grade, and 2nd grade. I am here, and I first have to say thank you to you, Susan, because I sat in on the hour-long joint ed meeting prior to this, and I heard some ideas coming into play about getting a reading interventionist at the Molin. For those of you who do not know, it's been 7 years since the Molin School has had a reading interventionist, and they have no math interventionist. And I know firsthand that these Molin teachers are unbelievable. I can speak about them till I'm blue in the face. They're amazing. But there are still those kids in each of those classrooms that need extra support. There's still going to be the bottom 10% of kids that need extra reading support. And I understand that 7 years ago, the need to put, you know, to take that reading specialist from the Molin and make her a special ed person, the need was there 7 years ago. But if you look at all the data since then, and in the last 7 years, there are kids who for 7 years we haven't been able to service, and we just pass them along. And somebody said earlier at the joint ed meeting about the reason for, I think it was you, Cheryl, the reason for putting all of these full-time Title I teachers at the Brez is to hit that little kids hard and get the early intervention for little kids, and I'm completely on board with that. I would never want to take that away from the Bresnahan. My daughter happens to be one who's been in the program, and I'm so thankful for it. But it's time to put something in place for the Molin as well. And I need to remind you all that the Molin School is still an elementary school. And never in my life have I, as a reading specialist, been part of a school mm-hmm. where reading services stop at 3rd grade. It is unheard of. Mm-hmm. And you're asking our kids to now take the PARC testing, which is an extremely rigorous test for our 4th and 5th graders. They need support. And I'm really thankful to you, Susan, to hear you earlier say that you have some ideas coming to be working with Tara on to get somebody in place, whether that's taking a full-time Title I person from the Brez and making her half-time, and just keeping that one person half-time Molin, half-time Brez, and that still leaves 3 full-time Title I teachers at the Brez. It would be lovely to have a full-time, but I know the money's not there, but we've got to put something in place for these Molin kids. They are still our elementary students. Thank you.
Anyone else? Thank you. Hearing no
questions.
Oh.
Is another Pat Lovett. I am a resident of Newburyport at 34 Oakland Street. I am the parent of children who have come through the schools. I am a teacher of 22 years in the schools, and I am the president of the Teachers Association. We thank you for finding the money, which never seems to be able to be found, for the replacement of the teacher at the second grade. But we believe very, very much so that finding a position is not enough. Our schools have been underfunded for years. They are underfunded on the backs of the people who are working in the school district now. The teachers, the support personnel, the instructional assistants. It is a people problem. The solution is not easy. It's not our job to find the solution. It's your job to find the solution. And there are many potential solutions, including overrides, including taxing to the maximum level, that you have chosen not to do. And the impact is on the people who work in the system, who spend thousands and thousands of hours off clock underwriting an underfunded school system. We are people short in our school department. Our SPED people, our special educators, our service providers are extraordinarily overwhelmed with the understaffing in that area to meet the goals that they have to meet. We need to have a solution now. We have heard year after year after year after year, there's no money. It's like a mantra. There's no money, there's no money, there's no money. Find the money, because this is an underfunded school department. And the teachers of Newburyport are suffering enormous amounts of stress because of the initiatives that we're operating under, the mandates that we're operating under, the social, emotional, and behavioral problems that are increasing in our community. We need more support. And it is not enough any longer to say, there is no money. Figure it out. Figure it out. Because we're tired of it.
Thank you. Anyone further? I want to thank you all for your public comment this evening. Consent agenda, do we have one, Mrs. Kennedy?
Yes.
Warrants? Mr. DeCanter, thank you. Yes.
I move that the following name bills of the Newburyport Public Schools amounting in the aggregate to $3,082.03 be approved and forwarded for the city auditor for payment. Second.
Any conflicts?
No conflicts.
Okay. Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries.
I move that the following named bills of the Newburyport Public Schools amounting in the aggregate $189,111.43 be approved and forwarded to the city auditor for payment if there are no conflicts.
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Is there another one, Mr. DeCanter?
That's it.
Thank you. I'd like to turn the committee's attention now. We have two separate sets of minutes for this evening. I would like to first draw your attention to the Newburyport School Committee public hearing, which included the FY17 budget and school choice on Tuesday, April 26th.
Motion to approve.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion, comment, changes? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. The second set of minutes I'd like to draw your attention to, Newburyport School Committee business meeting, Tuesday, April 26th, 2016. Could I hear a motion?
So moved.
Could I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Thank you. Clara, it's been a long time coming tonight. True?
We're now going to hear from our Newburyport High School representative to the school committee.
Chris Wino. So the group of students went on the Francis Maine trip, just got back last Monday from the trip, which I went on. It was really beautiful, and we learned a lot, and we did a lot with language.
Do you speak Spanish now?
I'm in German right now, actually.
Did it work?
German?
For your trip.
A little bit in France, actually. Interesting. Last Thursday was the Academic Awards Night, which was a fun event. AP testing is this week and next week, so juniors and seniors will be taking those tests. This Thursday is the staff appreciation lunch, because it's a half day, and the NHS Spring Play, but Life Spirit opens this Friday. And next Friday, the National Art Honor Society leaves for their New York trip, which that should be fun.
Trips. Any questions for Clara? Thank you very much. Do you have homework and you want to leave?
But
see that look. You have
week,
a what? You have what?
AP test this week.
Oh, bye.
Good luck.
Thank you. This brings us to the next item on our agenda, which is the FY17 budget discussion, followed by a vote. So I'd like to open up the discussion among committee members and the superintendent and the assistant superintendent. If anyone would like to open the discussion or make a comment?
Could I start off with a review of class size?
Very much so, yes.
Mrs. Davis, could you just review for the audience the class sizes for next year?
Based on second grade,
just go through like first grade what the sizes will be, second grade, third grade what the sizes will be.
Yes. First grade. Seven sections, 21 students. Second grade with the change as of this evening, or with the additional section added, hang on, I just covered up that new figure, 19 or 20 students per section. And in grade three, 21 or 22 students per section.
How many sections in second grade?
In second grade, there will be 7.
In third grade.
And in third grade, there will be 8.
And what is the class size in third grade for next year?
21 or 22. It's an average of 21. It's the percent. It's 21.75 students per class. So it's 21 and 22 per students in 8 sections.
So that second grade and third grade is 21 to 22 now?
Well, first and third.
No, second grade is 19 or 20.
I'm sorry, I was looking at first grade, yes.
So, sorry, go ahead.
Mr. Cole?
So second grade is actually down from what second grade is this year, correct?
Correct.
Okay. And could you repeat the first grade numbers for FY17?
Yes, 21 per classroom.
21.
Mm-hmm.
So that's up slightly from this year.
Correct, yes.
And the numbers that you're looking at, does that include the additional 10 students?
Yes, it does.
Okay. So we have put in there, based on our history, an additional 10 students that traditionally has moved in.
Exactly. We currently have 136 kindergartners. I've added 10 additional students because historically, 8 to 12 students move in the district. Currently, we do not have any newly registered students in grades 1, 2, or 3, but I've kept that 10 in as it is still early.
Okay. And Tara, Lauren, do you want to talk about class size in fourth and fifth grade and what some of the thoughts that we have about fourth grade?
So next year we have a smaller class size coming in. We've had two new fourth grade students register, so we're at 144 coming in right now. The same as with the Bresnahan, traditionally there are students that register over the summer. We've already actually had six students register for grade five, so we were at around 182, now we're at 188 students going into grade five for next year. We would like to keep our all of our staffing at grade four and at grade five, even though our grade four staffing would be lower next year, it would bring us to 18 in a class. Reasons being, we have no math interventionists, we have no literacy intervention at Molin. We have nine IAs to support about 70 students on IEPs, as well as our special ed and gen ed staff.
Just 70?
Yes.
Thank you.
We have no therapeutic program at the Molin School for some of our students that are really struggling socially, emotionally, and behaviorally. And in order to meet the needs of all of these students, it's in our best interest and the students' best interest to keep the current staffing that we have. Realistically, we would be needing to add IAs, that was my top budget request, was adding IAs and increasing STEM as a number of other positions. But without being able to do that, at this point, with the needs of the students that we have, and as some of my, some teachers have mentioned, as well as Ann Miles speaking to students that come in that need reading intervention, we are able to provide them with tier one intervention, which is intervention from the general ed teacher in the classroom. I am not referencing students that are on IEPs that get academic support. I'm referencing students that need literacy support, that receive it at the Bresnahan for Title I services, and then come to the Molin. In order for them to stay on grade level or reach grade level, they need some additional support above and beyond what a classroom teacher with 23 to 25 students in her class with no IA can do. And Molin has, in the past 4 years that I have been here, has had class sizes, and we are an elementary school, of 23 to 25 students. And I have teachers that have no IA support with that amount of students. So we feel, moving into next year without being able to add the reading or math intervention that we really need, that to be able to, at least for a year, keep class sizes smaller, or potentially do some moving around with staff, that would be in the best interest for our students.
One of the other conversations that Tara and I have had is that perhaps one of the things we want to look at is taking one of those positions, one of the classroom positions, and seeing whether or not we can turn that position into an interventionist to support our students. So that's another thing that's under discussion right now.
Yeah.
So we're looking at a variety of different options available and trying to be as creative as we can to meet students' needs. So
what would that do to the class size?
That would make the class size about 20.
Yes, a little around 20 to 21 in grade four.
Yes.
Thank you.
So that's an option that we will continue to discuss.
Mr. Cole.
Okay, so just to reiterate Principal Rossi, the current third grade cohort is going to be changing or going from 142 this year to 144 next year?
As of right now, and usually we do have additional students that also register during the summer.
And then the current fourth grade cohort is going to go from 182 to 188?
Yes.
Okay.
It's a big class.
So the fourth grade cohort for next year, how many sections do you project for that grade?
Well, currently we have eight fourth grade teachers. However, as was just mentioned, we are looking at restructuring potentially, voluntarily, staff for next year to provide some literacy or possible math intervention. Looking at data that I have for our fall, our current fourth graders in the fall, we had 25 students that were either right at the cusp of grade level or below grade level in literacy, and 29 for math. And those students are students that were not on IEPs. So that's a full class of students at grade four that could have used some kind of reading support to either stay on grade level or to bump them up to where they to get them as close as they need to be on grade level to move them up to fifth grade. And I also have the January data, because we assess three times with our new system. The January data shows that 19 of those same students have not made the progress needed to bring them up to grade level as of now.
So are you hoping to have the same number of sections then and work those support people in?
Either have the 8 sections with smaller class sizes so that the teachers can really dig in with the students, and or have 7 sections and put out to the staff to, if there's somebody that would be interested in doing some reading and math intervention for the next year. Yes.
And then pretty much the structure you have for fifth grade this year will apply to next year, because the numbers are pretty much the same?
The numbers are high. Those are high,
right?
Numbers. We will
absolutely
have 23 to 25 kids in the class.
Yeah, I can see that, yeah. All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Questions? Discussion? Comments on class size from the committee?
Yeah, I have a comment, yeah.
Mr. Cole?
Yeah, I appreciate the discussion about class size. I have to say for the record, though, this is something that was not brought to the school committee's attention. I believe at any point in this budget cycle, until I believe it's Ms. Goulart or that contingent from Marquand Lane that talked about class size. So thank you for doing that, and thank you for tonight's discussion.
Anything further?
I guess I still, you know, I sat in on the joint ed committee meeting prior to this meeting, and I still just have some concerns about the budget and the budgeting process overall. You know, we're talking about possibly starting school later a year from September and incurring some.
If you want this old man in the back of the room.
sorry. So we're talking about, you know, possibly starting school later in a year from September and incurring some additional busing costs. We're just wrapping up putting together a 3 to 5 year strategic plan with the community, of which I was on one of the strategic planning teams that came up with some great ideas. You know, we're also hearing about a lack of interventionists across the entire school system. We're one of the last schools to be charging tuition for kindergarten. We're currently offering only 4 full years of language instruction at the high school, where most districts in the state are offering at least 6 years of language instruction. And I just feel like, you know, some of the things on these lists are not nice to have things, they're really need to have things. And so while I appreciate that the mayor and the city council have very different jobs from the school committee, so my understanding is the school committee is meant to think about the best interests of the students, and I understand that the mayor and the city council need to balance out the needs of the entire city and all of the residents and all the wants and needs of all the residents. But, you know, listening to the joint ed meeting and going through this as my first budget process as a school committee member, and not seeing any discussion on how we're going to move forward on any of these big things that are on our plate in the next 3 to 5 years, I'm really struggling with, do I vote yes for this budget and essentially say, you know, I'm in agreement that I think this is the best we can do right now, or it sounds like if we were to reject this budget, it's the budget that's going to go to city council anyway. So I'm just curious as to whether we think, you know, is this really the best we can do this year? What are our plans moving forward in terms of finding a way to fill in some of these big things on the table still?
Does anybody want to comment on that? No. Thank you. Anything else, Mr. Hawkins?
No, I'm trying to compartmentalize a little bit and stay on class sizes. And so I'll just echo the idea that I'm appreciative that there was money found to keep the full-time teaching position in play. And while we are all inclined to be amazed that there's always money found, I do know that the state has announced more money's coming, so it's not just it's not as miraculous as it may seem that the mayor has money this week that wasn't around last week or even the week before, because that's the way May works in schools. So I do appreciate that. And I do appreciate the comments that people are making about class sizes and keeping them realistic. Maybe I've just been in urban schools for too long, but these class sizes seem pretty realistic to me. You know, I'll tell you, there are 8 or 9 students less, fewer than the students in my school. So not that I would want Newburyport to ever get there, but having, you know, 19 and 20 in an elementary room and an average of 20 or 21 in a upper elementary room seems like a good start. And there isn't going to be money for everything, so I'm trying to be more moderate than I'm known to be and to understand, like, if we're going to ask for some things, what aren't we going to be able to ask for? You know, like you, I'd love to know what the answer is for the long-term process. I sat on the strategic planning committees. We came up with a whole host of amazing things. I was fortunate enough to be invited, although I believe they're public, to the NEF Business Coalition meetings with Assistant Superintendent Bick, and those are pretty exciting places where people are talking about coming up with large chunks of money to do some of the innovative teaching that I heard mentioned tonight. And no, I don't know where this is going to go long term, but I guess for now I'm especially feeling good about having that one teacher back, and to know that Principal Rossi and the superintendent are working on some creative ways to find the interventions that I agree are needed, because they shouldn't stop for kids who need them just because the building switches. So I like that. I mean, I would be interested to know, like, from the high school perspective, because we haven't really heard much about anything, and there are some cuts on the table, so I don't know if maybe Mr. Parent, if you have anything you want to...
I'd love to get the FTEs at the high school back. You know, we instituted some new programs last year, and I cautioned the school committee that sustainability was the key to that success. And, you know, we added business back at the high school. We added a 0.4 in the science area. Again, talking about reducing class size and some, you know, hard science classes with labs and everything else. And this year, I'm faced with cutting 10% from each line item in my budget for supplies, materials, and books and computer purchases. And also, you know, having to look at it, the only other area I could go with the funding was personnel. And you know, I've got 0.6 basically as a placeholder as we move towards coming up with a schedule where the actual FTE cuts will be and what individuals and what departments. That could be a little fluid from what's been presented to you because we don't have the final numbers yet. We're close. We're very close. So I love to see if there's any more money to be found, that the 0.6 high school FTE cuts are the first things put back if more money was found.
I was a little surprised because I know you guys have been talking about chemistry and the hard sciences a lot over the years, as well as, like, you know, foreign language. We're talking about adding foreign language to the middle school, but that it's on the block, so I would also love to find more money for you, I promise.
It's not huge money, but when you're given a task of cutting a certain amount, you have to look at your entire budget and you have to make some hard decisions. And the hard decisions will be when we have, we're about 98% set on students having a full load for next year as far as what they're asking for in their core classes and electives. And we're still inputting some IC and numbers and some River Valley numbers. And when we get those in, we're doing those by hand. We're meeting with department heads this past, in the next week, to look at sections and numbers. And then I'm going to have to make a determination as to where those, that those three teaching, 0.2 teaching positions come from. And that's not going to be easy.
I guess I'll just also say, for those of you who weren't here beforehand, it was nice to talk to the Joint Ed Committee before this meeting was pretty unanimous in wanting a solution to the process and to the budgeting to find a way to start earlier and see if we can't squeak some more money out. That seems pretty universal. Even though there are constraints everywhere, people want the schools to succeed. So, you know, whether it feels like that or not, it's the only message I've ever gotten. No one's ever said, you know, the schools, I'm not sending any more money over that way. It's not like sitting in a bank somewhere doing nothing. So that was really refreshing and nice to hear.
And we are, I also want to say, we're looking at every dollar that we have. So that, for example, we have 6 retirements among our teaching staff. Depending upon at what level we hire someone, there may be some savings there. We may be able to find some additional monies once all that's done. The budget process is a very fluid process. I'm talking with the administration at Bresnahan, and we're looking at filling a position there and maybe getting creative with a position that we're filling there in terms of our library media and what we might be able to do with that. So that these conversations are pretty constant, and we're trying to capture every dollar that we can. We recently received a Safe and Supportive Schools grant. We are trying to bring in revenue as well as cut our expenses. At last week's school committee meeting, one of the things that was presented where there was some significant savings was in the area of energy. And Steve Bergholm, our facilities manager, presented looking at our heating, ventilation, and air conditioning, and just all of the things that he's done in that area to save money. Whenever we can save money on that side, then the hope is that we can put that money back into personnel. Because what was said tonight, that is really what we need. We need additional personnel. And it is because of all the reasons that were stated earlier tonight. We do have more complicated kids coming to school. When you have more kids who are in a class and they have greater needs, it's much more difficult for teachers to manage. So the fact that we can keep class size down and we can begin to get some additional supports in place to address the needs that kids have. And even though we're Newburyport, we have a very broad range of students who come into our buildings every single day. So I want to make that really clear. We have the same problems that the cities do. Maybe they're in smaller amounts, but we have the same problems. And we have kids that are experiencing social emotional issues across the board, from pre-K all the way up through high school. And the issues are starting earlier and earlier. When I'm hearing about our youngest students who end up being hospitalized because of anxiety or social emotional issues, you know, 20 years ago when I was in the classroom, that was not the case. So, but those are the realities that we as a public school have to deal with every day. So I just want to say that we're doing everything on our side, the administrative side, to see how we can, if we can eke out, you know, another 0.2 of someone, another 0.4. And that's the mindset that we have. How can we do this to support the students who are in front of us every single day?
Beth and Lisa, could you talk a little bit about the makeup of the NOC vis-a-vis your class sizes? And we have a chart in front of us that was given to us. So you have some interventionists at your level. And class size, I have a really clear picture now about the Molin. I don't have as clear a picture of the NOC, so.
Our class sizes academically, and I say that specifically for a reason, range from 18 to 24, which is still fairly healthy. Every now and then we'll get a bubble class and we'll go over that. But that's what it looks like for next year. I think where it's deceiving in the middle school is in our explore rotation. Our explore rotation is, the class sizes are larger. I've spoken to this each time I think I've been at the school committee meetings, and you know, it looks like last year we added more art, but you know, when you really take a look at art in the middle school, we have a 1.0 teacher for 500 plus students with a budget of about $15 per student. You know, when you talk about foreign language, you know, the answer is show me the money. That's what it takes to buy more teachers to put, to develop a program. If you looked at our budget proposals from last year, when we were told we had to cut back, we projected out 3 years, what did we want to build back in? And we have about 105 students that are on some type of a plan. The last four students that were enrolled in our school, none of them speak English. So our ELL population is rising. With 105 students on a plan, you know, it's not easy to look at special ed services and personnel on paper. A lot of students, as Susan just said, are very complicated. It depends on what's written in an IEP, how many hours do they require. So with that 105, we haven't added any special ed. As a matter of fact, in September we lost one. And we also lost our therapeutic program. So I would say we're still okay, but in terms of intervention, we need to add there as students come up through the ranks with special needs that we don't even have right now. We added a 0.5 reading teacher 2 years ago as a consultant. We added her to our staff last year. We're trying to build capacity with the Wilson program training. But that gets very complicated with scheduling. We did have to cut in this budget another 0.5 reading that we really thought would satisfy the needs of all the IEPs that we already have written.
What about regular education intervention?
Regular education intervention, I took 3 years ago one of our special ed staff, made that person an interventionist. That was David Clay. Mm-hmm. Then David went into the therapeutic program, and Brenda Palmisano, who was a current special ed teacher, I took her out of that rotation and created the intervention position. So she does serve general ed students that are struggling in math or ELA specifically, although we are still, we could use one at every grade level, to be quite honest with you. So we're making do with what we have in that area. But as kids come up the ranks, you remember we've added new math programs, we're adding new science programs, we're adding all of this, and then we add PARC on top of it, and kids are struggling, and that's, you know, leads to the anxiety and all those types of services. But the class size is where we have had to be really creative and do everything different. Our academic class sizes are 18 to 24, but our explore rotation classes are a little bit larger. Mm-hmm. That's the three-year plan that we haven't been able to do.
Can I just ask, you said you have 105 students on IEPs?
I have 105 students on between IEPs and 504. See, that's another thing in the mix.
Yeah.
We forget about students on a 504 that require services and people. But they're here. They're real. They need our time. They need our care. They are. There's a lot of them. But, you know, and then we have the whole realm of anxiety that's moved into our schools, and we're trying to take care of all of it and with the best of our abilities, and this is why we have crowd.
And at the Mullen, you said there were 70-something on plans?
We have around 70 on IEPs, and that did not include 504s.
70 on actual on IEPs.
Into next year.
Yeah. Is that the same at the Bresnahan? Because we're looking at 30, 35 kids per grade?
It's higher at the Bres.
Especially if you factor in preschool and children that are just coming to us and starting out, that we hope to move off of IEPs through early intervention.
Like on average per grade, that you do know, like what that looks like?
In each of my five preschool classes, we have on average 6 students on IEPs alone in preschool.
Out of?
There are 5 sections this year, so that's at least 30 students.
30 students out of how many total?
30 students out of how many?
Yeah.
About 80.
So almost half.
But that's typical, Dave. That's part of the model for preschool.
Okay. And that goes up through grades 1 through 3 also?
Our numbers are currently high, and we've had an extensive number of evaluations this year.
We have a lot of evaluations that are requested, and you know by law.
Yep.
And I will add that the request from parents for testing often is a result that we don't have the appropriate amount of interventions to catch it before it gets there. You know, when I arrived here 4 years ago, all roads led to an IEP, and we tried to put stopgaps in place for that. But, you know, we've got to take care of the need, and that's the interventions that we need.
Okay, thank you.
Could you, not all of you, but could a couple of you talk about how your RTI teams function? Because as Beth, you just mentioned, all roads led to an ed plan, and that's why RTI was put into the district. So can you talk to me a little bit about that, Tara?
I'm happy to speak to how it works at Mullen, because I think that, you know, we have a very thoughtful, thorough RTI team. I think when a student is recommended to RTI, it's a thoughtful team that sits down and discusses the student and looks at academics, looks at social, emotional, all of the pieces, looks at the whole child, and makes recommendations for an intervention. And so that intervention will be put in place, and this is another area where I can speak for Mullen and applaud my entire staff, because they always step up to the plate, and our sped teachers often will take on RTI students and add an RTI student to their caseload to do a 6 to 8 week intervention. You know, we think outside the box. We use programs like Lexia to work to help kids, support them in reading, but a program is not a person. So, you know, then we come back to the table, we look at the progress that's been made, and if we're consistently seeing that progress is not being made, then the team will decide if that student needs to be evaluated. I wouldn't say, though, that the majority of requests for evaluations come from RTI. We have a lot of requests from outside of the school for evaluations.
And that's what I'm understanding. So that's another whole piece there that, and you were also mentioning that you have no interventionist, so I'm assuming that most of the intervention is done by the classroom teachers in that case.
Right, and I'm gonna say, honestly, the reality of this is that the classroom teachers are so thorough and so wonderful that they've already tried all the interventions, so by the time they're recommending a student to RTI, they've already done the work, and so, yes. So they've done their job, they've done it well, and at that point, we're really looking to try and add a different piece and think outside the box creatively.
I'm glad to hear that. Yep.
Cheryl, I'll just add that at the earlier levels, the RTI process is really very essential, because a student, as a parent, I think Kira said earlier, they don't all read at the same time, they don't all walk at the same time, we've all heard that. Just because a student might not be picking up on reading or might not be picking up on math or maybe their articulation is off in speech doesn't necessarily mean that a child has a disability. Doesn't mean that a child automatically needs special education services. It does mean that they need interventions and they need supplements to their curriculum to help them. And I think that is what we do very, very well. At the Bresnahan, it's not uncommon that we might even have a speech and language pathologist be working on a 6 to 8 week plan for a student who we don't think has a speech disability but may need some help with their language processing or their articulation. So what we do is we try to safeguard making that leap to diagnose in a very young child with a major type of disability. What we're hoping to do is remediate, and we remediate through Title I services, through our math interventionists, and through our related service providers. You don't have to be in an IEP to receive help from our related service providers as long as their schedules allow. And
you have them.
We have them. So I think that we do an excellent job with that. We have a
really dedicated team of teachers. We run a pre-K RTI team every week on Fridays. We run a kindergarten separate RTI team and a grades 1-3 RTI team on Wednesday. They meet weekly. We track data, we look at that data. Sometimes we'll move to a more intensive intervention. And if we feel like we've really exhausted the interventions, then at that point, we might make a request for a referral. But it isn't an immediate jump there. It's how can we support this child to meet the needs that they need early in their career.
Thank you.
I'd just like to add, too, that the Title I team and the math interventionist tend to refine their practice year after year. We've only had the math interventionist now for a little over, about a year and a half. But the Title I team has been in place for many, many years. And they have been reflecting upon when they collect data and what data they will use to determine the students that they will pick up. So for example, some years they were choosing the data from the beginning of the year. Now they tend to look at the end of the year data so that they can then pick up students at the very beginning of the year rather than losing ground at the beginning of the year. So start working with students beginning at the very beginning of the school year, then collect some additional data in the fall, but make sure that they're working with students from the very beginning rather than losing 6 or 8 weeks while the classroom teachers are collecting data and while they're collecting data. And that seems to give those students who are in immediate need a foundation to get going, and that seems to be a nice way to get started. So they're continuously fine-tuning their practice as well, which is nice. And that's all a part of the process in terms of RTI as well. There's a connection there.
Thank you. Anything else?
I guess real quick, just because you brought it up, do you mind if I ask, when you say collect data, like classroom data, or is there something you're using? Like, what do you, when you say collect data, what are they?
The classroom teachers collect the benchmark data, mm-hmm. As well as DIBELS data. And the Title I team supports the classroom teachers oftentimes in collecting that DIBELS data. And the Title I team also collects some additional data at the beginning of the year. And the classroom teachers collect some additional data as well.
Okay.
And that data is collected multiple times during the school year. That will help the classroom teachers determine their small group instruction,
mm-hmm.
The groupings for small group instruction, as well as refine those groups throughout the course of the year. But it will certainly help identify who the students will be for the Title I intervention in grades 1, 2, and 3, as well as kindergarten.
And I would just add to that data could be anything. If you're bringing a child to RTI, it could be for even behavioral or emotional concerns. And if we put them on an intervention plan, we would write individual specific goals for that child, and the data that we collect could be how they're responding to that. So some of the data might not be as straightforward as DIBELS testing, it could be individual data that we're collecting maybe through a behavior improvement plan or something else in that particular child. And then the RTI team will reconvene in that short-term interval to see if there are improvements or not, and is the intervention working. And if it's not, then we would put in place another intervention.
Thank you.
Anything further from the committee?
On the budget stuff?
Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Yes, Mr.
Sure.
Cole.
Thank you. First, just for housekeeping, I apologize. I said Marquand Ave earlier. It's Marquand Lane. I'm sorry. And that's important to me. Anybody who remembers when I used to chair school committee meetings here, I pride myself in identifying everyone by their name and proper address when recognizing them. So I apologize for getting that wrong. But not what I really want to cover here. And it's going to start with what the superintendent said about 6 retirements. Most of the folks out there who are teachers, and I know there's a lot of them out there, Most of you know that since I joined the committee in 2004, I've never missed a Newport school retirement event at either the Elks or the Seaglass, correct? Mm-hmm. Never missed one. Thank you. So I just want to do something interactive with you here. Can I see hands of teachers that are at the highest step on the teaching scale right now? Okay. Can I see hands of teachers who were in their first 4 years? One? Is that one back there? Okay, two. Okay, great. Okay. I'd like folks that are beyond those first 4 years to try to think back, and I'm sure you remember quickly, your first 4 years as teachers. Getting your degree, paying your union dues, working on your master's, dealing with housing costs, dealing with commuting costs, dealing with presentation and wardrobe, working hard, working extra, bringing the state-of-the-art knowledge to your job and to our school district. It's really important. My classmate, Ms. Hoyseth, we're both NHS 76, there she is. She mentioned the importance of what we want to be like in 5 or 10 years. And I got to tell you, from being the only NHS or Newburyport alumni on this committee, that means a lot to me. And when I think about where I was in school back in 76, and I have to say there were many days when I made my walk home to the South End from this school after having a bad day, and my stomach kind of felt a little wheezy when I left this place. And I got to tell you, it's feeling that way today for some reason. But what I want to say is that I realize the importance of that, and I realize the importance of sustaining our educational staff. But I also realize the importance of sustaining programs. We need programs. And I'm going to touch on the retirement thing again. Again, I've been to every retirement event that's been held. I know there's been some years we haven't held them. One of my memorable events was when I got to present former NTA President Ed Carter with a framed print of the Jackman School. And it happened to be that Mr. Carter, class of 66, was my seventh grade teacher there in his first year. And so he, and it was in 2006, he and I actually signed a teacher's contract that year. It was my first year as vice chair, and he was president of the Teachers Association. And that year, I gave him that print. And another time, I think in, I forget what year it was, but when Kevin Lyons was superintendent, he and I presented the retiring teachers their certificates of retirement to include Danny Sullivan. So I've had some memorable experiences with the retirement process. But what I really want to focus on is, again, the importance of the programs, because at each one of those retirements, I've had teachers come up to me, or I've had teachers, retired teachers, if I've been walking on the rail trail, they'll come up to me and say, "Hey, Steve, you know what? You guys got to stop cutting programs. You guys got to stop cutting programs." It takes a team effort to stop cutting programs, and I've talked to this committee before that I really would like to see school committee members at the table when leadership talks about programs. I know we can't be there for personnel stuff, but I think it's really important that school committee is at the table so we can talk about programs, so we can set priorities, so we can make some of those important decisions. I also need to say something about coaches, because as you all, and there are some teacher coaches out there right now, and I got to tell you, from, again, coming through the system, I had a gentleman for an algebra teacher, and there's a coach by the name of Paul Finn. And Paul Finn wasn't probably the most electric coach, but you know what? He was probably the fairest coach I've ever experienced in any school, college, that I've had the pleasure to play for. Paul Friend was a remarkable, and he's a remarkable man. At that time was a remarkable algebra teacher, and probably had over 600, if not 700 wins as a JV baseball, basketball coach. and the fairest coach I've ever had. And since then, I've come to appreciate many coaches that my children have had. And they've helped build them into fine young adults. And they've also provided them recommendations and the opportunity to either help them go to college or to earn college scholarships. And I'll mention three of them. Kevin Sheridan, Jay Murphy, and of course, Don Henniger. Those coaches are important. And I can't believe that we haven't done enough to address the equality that those coaches deserve, whether it be within the Cape Ann League or within the state of Massachusetts, because we really have a tradition of Clipper pride that is really fostered by our coaches in Newburyport. And lastly, I got to talk about foreign language. I first got introduced to foreign language when I was at the Jackman School in the South End. And it's very sad for me when I see children in Newburyport not being introduced to that now. And I was told a few years ago to be patient about foreign language. Well, I'm no longer patient. I am going to insist, and I'm not going to be stifled. The other interesting thing, growing up in the South End, I used to have a paper route, and on my paper route was one Bradley Fuller. And later on in life, when I was the chair of the Salvation Army Advisory Board, one of my board members was Brother Joe Stanwood, another longtime school committee member. And while I was on the Salvation Army Advisory Board, there was another gentleman, Norman Doyle, a 40-plus year school committee member. Those were the guys that set the pace for me. Those were the gentlemen that weren't stifled. And I promise you, I'm not going to be stifled moving forward here, because I'm not happy with where things are. But I really want to encourage everybody to come together, because, you know, I think everybody wants to do well for everyone here, but it has to be fair. We can't forget about programs. We can't forget about coaches. We can't forget about things like foreign language that should be happening and that are not, okay? As the world goes global, Newburyport can't shake its head and says, we don't need to do that. If there's one thing I learned at Newburyport is how to critically think, and I promise you to continue that. I appreciate everybody coming out and advocating for the budget. I just want to ask you to think of those key factors, though. Let's not forget about them. It's all related to what makes this a good school, good if not premier school district. Thank you.
Mr. DeCantor?
Thank you, Ms. Sweeney. I have a laundry list here on my piece of paper that was generated somewhat by memory, but wasn't hard to generate. Let me read some of the items to you. Appropriate class size, interventionists, language instruction, arts, STEM, full-day kindergarten, fully funded, coaches, strategic plan, the NOC Explorer schedule. And while all of these are subjects that have come up just this year, in one way or another, they're also items that have been on our agenda year after year after year after year after year after year. And every year we have the same solution. We'll get creative. And we do. We get creative on one of those items. This year, the cause of the year that we got creative on and got some money to fund was the appropriate classroom size at the Bresnahan. Last year, we were able to rescue our freshman sports. These are valuable things, and I thank the mayor for finding the money for doing that. But when we take a look at that list, we can't continue to go issue by issue putting a Band-Aid on them. We have a strategic planning process that is nearing its completion. And that needs to be put forward as a way for finally going back to the city, the way some of us have been talking about for year after year after year, and saying, hey, we need to solve our revenue problem. We're not going to cost save our way out of these issues. We're not going to bring foreign languages back by cost savings. We're not going to give coaches the recognition they deserve, the financial support they deserve, through cost cutting. We've been down that road. We've cut down to the bone. And while each year when we talk about this, it tends to be at about this time of the year when we're talking about budgets and approving the budget. At this point, for this budget, I'm not sure there's much we can do. But now is the time that we need to start laying the groundwork for next year's budget. Now is the time to put together our case. We've got marvelous, marvelous citizens in Newburyport who have stepped up to the plate to help us pass the Bresnahan, to help us pass the NOC renovations. And you know what? I wouldn't doubt that the city also probably ought to be talking about an override. I heard the mayor at our last meeting talk about the fact that, and she's right, she has nowhere else to get from, that she's down two police officers and that she's down to one fire station.
No, I didn't say that. I said, what do you want me to do, close a fire station? We can't do that, you know, but we're still short positions on the fire station also.
So we need to take a good look at ourselves as a city and say, what kind of a city do we want to be? I'm on the school committee, so I will be talking about what kind of school system we want to have. I hope that city councilors and ward councilors step up and join us in saying, now is the time to take a look at our revenue stream and what we can do. It's not going to come from the state. It's not going to come from the feds. And even though I may be rotund and have a white beard, it's not going to come from Santa Claus.
Could we go over the process of...
Can I just speak for a minute?
Oh, sure. Sorry. Oh,
no, that's okay. I wanted to give the school committee members a chance to speak. Every year, this is an incredibly difficult process. I don't think there's any question about it. And I'm not trying to, as I say about putting money forward every year to the budget. Of course there's going to be an increase every year to the budget. That's, you know, I mean, standard is a 2.5%, you know, and that, you know, most, if I look across our school districts, neighboring school districts, most of them are, Amesbury's 2.4% is increased this year, Melrose doing 2.2. But the difference in these other school districts is if you look at what their percentages of that they're getting for aid, Amesbury gets 28% of their budget from aid. Haverhill 60%, Tewksbury 28%, Melrose 21%, Linfield 26%, Salem 27%, Newburyport 7%. We get probably the lowest amount of state aid, and this is part of the reason why we advocated so hard with the Education Foundation Group. We went and testified, we pushed, we've signed the resolution, the city council has signed the resolution. I have every single year put every dime I can forward to the schools. Every time we find, as you know, more Chapter 70 money comes in, city council looks at the budget, they might make another $40,000, $50,000, $60,000, $70,000, even $80,000 in cuts. That money has always been shifted to the schools. So it's not that I'm, you know, saying that we have, you know, I'm giving all this money to schools. I understand the challenge. We have a structural deficit. Because we host a charter school, because we have a charter school, this year it's probably going to be over $3 million that's going to the charter school. And no one is saying that charter schools shouldn't be an option, as Whittier should be an option for all of our students. Parents should have options about what is the best method to teach and raise their child. But we're at a point now when we're getting only a little over $2 million to fund a $30 million operating budget. I have polled, you know, city budget carries the $5 million in health insurance. We carry all of the school's capital needs in a separate budget. We carry pensions in a separate budget. I have worked as hard as I can to find every way to pull everything out of the budget except personnel and supplies. And now we're up to $30 million. What we're required to spend, which I think is absurd from the state, is $22 million. So, you know, we recognize that, you know, what our minimum amount is absurd because that doesn't make sense for our community. So I don't think that us getting angry with each other, standing up and threatening, or some of the emails I have received, is helpful. We're in this together to try and figure this out. We have students getting into good colleges. Our accreditation was wonderful. Thank you, all the high school teachers and all the work you did in our accreditation. It was exceptional. We're now back up in the top 50 at schools. One of the things that was really important to our district was to stop the revolving door of administrators and teachers. And so when other people in the city were asked to take zeros, we never asked the teachers to do that. We never asked you to do that because we knew you were underfunded. Now our salaries are in the top 12% where they should be and where you should be receiving salaries, because one of the most important things in any job is to educate our children. So I'm really proud of the things that we have accomplished. We have a brand new elementary school. We have renovated Knockmolen. We're giving the teachers the tools they need. And now we have to figure out how to get the personnel and the programs back. We've started little by little each year putting something here that was the highest priority. A budget, you know, adding a 0.5 interventionist here, or a 0.5, adding a STEM person. You know, this is the best we can do with the budget we have. Please understand that we have another almost 18,000 people living in this community, and that they pay taxes and they expect services also. 60% of our budget goes towards education. So we need to figure this out. How are we going to get to the next point to put things back? And we need to work together to do that. So this year, I mean, one of the things that we were promised, as I said earlier, with the state, 20% of casino revenues were supposed to go to education. We have been working with our legislatures. I now sit on an advisory board, and I meet 6 to 8 times a year with the governor and lieutenant governor. And so we have an opportunity face-to-face to talk to them about the problems with funding. If you can't fix the Chapter 70 funding formula, just give us back the money that you're taking to the charter school. What we could do with that $2.5 million is incredible. That would make such a huge difference in terms of what our needs are. So we have the potential of casino money coming. We have the Education Foundation. We have our legislatures who get it. They understand. But it's also an election year for them. So I don't know how far they're going to push on this issue, but we need to continue, you know, keep, you know, rallying at that level also. And in the meantime, the only other solution we have for this year is I'm going to go back to what President O'Brien said. Would the teachers consider helping us this year?
You didn't even raise taxes to 2.5. Do that first.
We raised them to 1.75% and made up, and made, could I finish please? And made up the difference with free cash of what would have come in.
Right, so you did not raise taxes to the level that the state in 1980 decided was the minimum amount that you needed. Not the amount you need when you're building new schools and doing all kinds of other things. The minimum amount that was needed. You still didn't do that. That to me says you have plenty of money.
No, it's not. It was the city council listening to their constituents during an election year where people were telling them they're really hurting.
No.
They're really hurting in terms of taxes and in terms of water and sewer.
But
well, that's
2.5 is minimum.
My recommendation to the council was the full 2.5%. The council decided to follow suit with the 1.75%. But that's, you know, that's what happened. We made up the difference by transferring free cash into what would have been that $300,000 revenue that would have come in, and that's where we are right now. We can't go back and change what the vote was in November.
Thank you, Mayor.
I just wanted to add one other piece that I'm not sure a lot of the public understand. They see that the teachers' contracts were funded at the cost of living raises, but below that are the steps and columns. And most of the public doesn't understand that. That translates to anywhere from a 1.8 to 4% increase on top of cost of living every year. That's hard. That's a big increase every year. When you're getting a 2.5 plus another 1.8 or 2%, that in 1 year for one teacher, that's difficult. That's been hard for us to do. I mean, that's just a fact.
Can you talk in this? Are you allowed to respond or comment, or is it just to read?
We usually have one session of public comment.
How do I know?
You usually do, but he clearly has something to say, so do you think that maybe we could take a minute and let him speak his mind?
Committee?
Sure.
Thank you.
I just think the 12% is a little misleading. When I came to teach here from Lynn's school department, I took a $4,000 pay cut to come teach in Newburyport.
Mm-hmm.
I love teaching here. I love my community. I love the stuff we've done with the schools and everything. Proponent for my without campaigning for all those things we've done in our schools here. But I don't think it's fair to say like we're this elaborate teaching salaries here. I don't have that. If I stayed in Lynn, I'd be making $12,000 more than I currently do now. If I stayed in Lynn school systems, the way they're set up, I think we have a lot of maybe higher people because of the long term that we teach here because we love our community and teachers stay here. That's awesome. It's a testament to what we do here. But I think 12% is a bit misleading to the public in general and to everyone saying that. I have like friends who looked at teaching here and they choose not to go into Newburyport because our system of the way our contracts are set up aren't very good actually compared to other school systems, and they'll lose thousands of dollars by coming and teaching to report if they didn't stay in Chelmsford or stay in Lynn or stay in another school system. So it really is not set up as well as I think it's misleading in saying that. So I just want to let that out there.
Thank you.
Anything further?
And as I have said, every time that there is extra money, it goes towards the schools and as we move through this process. But I am obligated to present a balanced budget to the city council on Monday night, and that's what I will do.
So let's go down that procedural line for
Can
a moment.
Speak up, please.
I'll try. I'm going to go down that procedural road for a moment. What happens if we decline to pass the budget this evening? Mayor, could you address that?
I have to put forward a budget on
louder so that
I have to put forward a budget to the city council that is balanced on Monday night.
So could you?
That's not going to answer the question. What happens if it's not passed?
I still put forward the budget that was developed by the leadership.
So you'll present it anyway.
Yes.
And so to clarify, does the difference become then that the city council would end up approving the school budget without the school committee approving it?
Correct.
Okay.
Anything further from the committee? Are we ready to take a vote? Can we have a roll call, please, Mrs. Kennedy?
Yes.
Don't you have to make a motion with expenses and salaries detailed?
Yes, I do.
I'm going to leave that up to the superintendent. You need to.
This is no process.
you have that documentation, Mr. Cole?
No, I don't.
Okay, thank you.
So you have to add, what was this teacher for second grade? 55, 60, what do I need for the teacher for second grade? The teacher salary for second grade, 55, 60? I'm asking Christina. I'm asking you the salary for a second grade teacher.
55.
55, so add that to the salaries, 55. That's an average, so just, that's fine. We'll make sure it works.
Thank you, I'm sorry.
Last word of the room to know.
So the FY '17 budget by category, including the teacher that we just restored this evening, salaries would be in the amount of $23,106,504, if my math is correct. I am not a mathematician. Expenses, $7,650,447.
Give me that figure again.
Yes, 7,650,447. Let him quickly. All right.
35,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7,7
$30 million.
$30 million. Somebody else. Okay,
I'd
sorry.
Like it to be 37.
There was something that must have been in my head. Sorry for the error. $30,756,951. Could I hear a motion, please?
Motion to approve.
Could I hear a second?
Second.
Discussion? Could we have a roll call vote, please, Mrs.
Yes.
Kennedy?
That was to approve the salaries and expenses
for the FY17 budget.
Ms. Miller?
Opposed.
Mr. DeCanter?
Yes.
Mr. Cole?
No.
Mr. Menon is not here. Ms. Sweeney?
Yes.
Mr. Hawkeiser?
Yes.
Mayor Holliday?
Yes.
Four yes and two no, one absent. Thanks, Steve.
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr. DeCanter.
I move that we instruct the school committee to start the process of working with the city council to request an override effort in order to increase our revenue stream for our schools next year and not wait until it's too late.
Second.
Discussion. I think also as part of that, I'm going to request that our own FinCom committee work out some sort of a timeline. And instead of moving from the beginning to the end, last year I think the same thing happened to us, that we were down to the last minutes in trying to understand this budget. So I would like to charge the Finance Committee, of whom I am a member,
of working on a time schedule that goes backwards from the city council vote and figure out how we get more information earlier in this process. And I think we spoke about this last year as well. I believe it's happened to us again this year, and I'm not comfortable with that.
Can I request that, that be a separate motion? Because mm-hmm. I don't think they're tied together, but they're not mm-hmm. the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Do I hear a second for Mr. DeCantor's motion?
We have one.
David.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Second motion? I would like the finance committee, am I okay?
Yeah, you're
good. Oh, I would like the finance committee to work on a timeline that gives us the opportunity to have more information about the budget earlier in the year. I would like to work backwards from when it's due to the city council. I realize that this year we had a snow day, which would have given us another conversation, but I still don't think that's enough. I'd like to hear a second.
Second.
Discussion.
I fully support this effort. I think there is a lot of work that is done by the leadership team to put these budgets together. There are a lot of decisions that are made. But until the pushing and pulling is done, I don't feel I have a sense for where the school might be going with, where the schools might be going with their recommendations. So I would agree with that.
And further discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. This brings us to our superintendent's report. I'm very sorry. No, it doesn't. It brings us to our Bresnahan partnerships with colleges. Principal Christina Davis.
Hi. Sorry. So I am here to speak about our partnerships with Endicott College, Salem State University, and also Merrimack College. So this is kind of a nice shift after all the talks for the last couple of hours. It's something very pleasant to
I need you to speak up a little. I can hardly hear you, I'm sorry. That won't help. That won't help.
That's for the TV.
It's just for the cable.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm here to speak about the partnerships that we have with Endicott College, Salem State University, and Merrimack College. I have a handout to share with all of you this evening that I will pass around. Actually, I'm going to keep one. What's that? Oh, sure, there should be plenty. We have had the unique pleasure of working with two colleges in one university this year at Bresnahan School. We have had a number of teachers, as you can see based on the document that I just passed around, where a number of kindergarten, first grade, second grade, as well as a third grade teacher and a special educator have supported student teachers from Salem State University and Endicott College. We have also had the opportunity to support a fellow, a fifth year graduate student from Merrimack College, who is receiving her master's in education along with a second license in special education. And it's been a wonderful opportunity, not only for her, but also for all of the student teachers. We have been working with program coordinators as well as lead professors from both the university and Endicott College as well. I have had the pleasure of working with these lovely people from both Salem State and Endicott, as well as Amy Sullivan. I've attended, along with Susan, mock interviews supporting seniors who will be graduating from Endicott. We were invited to participate in mock interviews to help them prepare for the real thing, as they will be interviewing in local communities as well as places far, far away. And also, I will be attending a dinner this Wednesday evening at Endicott in honor of all of the local districts that are supporting these partnerships in supporting their student teachers that are preparing to move on. We are in the process of expanding the partnership as we will be preparing for the fall. We already have student teachers planning on joining us again next year, and we have teachers who are already planning on working with the students at Bresnahan Hand School in kindergarten, first grade, and second grade. We have early childhood majors as well as one elementary major thus far. All of them so far are from Endicott, and we are expecting to have student teachers as well from Salem State University. We're also very excited that, and we just learned that we will also be having a fellow again for the upcoming school year from Endicott College. This year's fellow is from Merrimack.
I have an opportunity to, you see Lauren Sabordi, was one of the student teachers that we had, and she happened to be one of the students that that I did the mock interview with. And as anyone would, she was raving about the teachers that she worked with and couldn't say enough about her experience at Bresnahan. So that's really been the feedback from all of them. And the advantage for us as a school district is that this really gives us a pipeline to some very talented young men and women who, you know, we may be able to hire in the future. So it's a really nice, it's been very, very positive.
And we already did. One of our student teachers from the fall, we hired as an instructional assistant for second semester. And she's doing a fantastic job, just fantastic. She's actually working in third grade with Renee Ames. And just so dedicated and committed and just
so
amazing.
So what are these student teachers that take over the full classroom, or?
They start out observing and working.
And they're here for a whole semester?
They're here for a whole semester. The early childhood students, as you can see, work with two teachers. Mm-hmm. And that's because they have to complete student teaching in two settings. So they're 8 weeks in a kindergarten environment, and then another 8 weeks, and it doesn't have to be kindergarten, but that's how it worked out, and then another 8 weeks in a first grade environment. So they end up taking over in both environments. An elementary student teacher would stay in an elementary classroom for a full 16 weeks. Mm-hmm. And we will also have student teachers in the fall that will be doing that. You can see down below where Kim Dow is located here for Salem State University documented. Amanda completed a full 16 weeks with her because she's an elementary major, not an early childhood major. But yes, they end up doing a full takeover for 2 weeks at the elementary level. But with the early childhood, it's 1 week in the first and early childhood environment, and then another 1 week in the second early childhood environment.
Now, I know Salem State University used to give vouchers Do they still do that for teacher classes and?
They do.
So is it still that the person who has the student teacher gets the first shot, and then what do? Open it up to the school or the voucher?
Typically, the voucher will go to those that have the student teachers.
But if someone's not going to use it, is it transferable?
That's a good question. I'm not sure.
It used to be. I don't know if...
I'm not sure about that. We'd have to...
And is it a voucher for a full class or an amount?
I'm not sure, to be honest with you. Okay. I would have to ask. They go directly to the teachers. I don't know, but I could ask.
Well, I'm thinking about, you know, our budget for tuition and, you know, if that could supplement it at all.
Yeah.
Do you intend to grow this or...?
Well, it's growing. I mean, we've always had student teachers,
right.
But this year was incredible. We've had more student teachers this year as a result of the three schools. It really is dependent on the number of students that the college or university has to offer
mm-hmm.
us at this
mm-hmm.
point.
So this year you had eight?
This year
eight?
We had the 4, 7, 8, yes. And I don't know. Right now we're working with Endicott. They were ready first.
Mm-hmm.
We should be hearing from Salem State anytime. So we'll see.
And we want to continue to grow.
Well, that's right.
But it's really dependent on what they
have. Can we put
some
over in Roland?
I'm hoping.
Absolutely, yes. That's, I guess, what I was asking. More
yeah.
are we growing?
It really
something?
Started through central office.
You get some relief.
Yes, I'm hoping to be able to interview some.
Good.
As soon as we get
that's
meetings.
For the fellow, where all the schools
fellows,
are going
yeah.
to have a fellow.
We hope. We hope.
Oh,
we
hope.
We hope. If we can.
We're just really excited.
How about
because
a fellow S?
A fellow S. So we had the opportunity to have a fellow this year. For Merrimack, and it went over so well that we do hope that all the schools will be able to have a fellow this year.
And it's dependent upon a couple of things. It's dependent upon, do they have students who are interested in particular areas and grade levels
sure.
who are available. So, you know, we really want to continue to grow this because it's a great opportunity for them. It's a great opportunity for us. The fellows are here for the entire school year.
Which
and
is amazing.
184 days. So, I mean, it doesn't get any better than that. The student teachers are here, you know, 16 weeks, but that doesn't mean they're here from day one through the entire semester. But, it, you know, still, 16 weeks is great. It's fantastic. We've had student teachers from Northern Essex, from Leslie College, from, you know, from a number of schools. But the partnerships that Susan has brought in has definitely enhanced the number of student teachers that we've had this one year alone. The student teachers are typically in the fall because that's when they do their student teaching at the schools. But we're looking to see how many more we'll be able to have next fall. And there will be an opportunity if there are students as seniors who work on a special education additional certificate that we may be able to have second semester. We didn't end up with any of those seniors this year, but there may be a chance next year with a special ed certificate. So that's maybe another opportunity.
Could you find a reading specialist?
That would be mm-hmm. awesome.
We have one person.
Sorry, I'm just trying to help.
We actually have one. There's one person who's in that packet that I gave you.
Yep.
That,
great.
So.
That would
be great.
I'll
reach out to
you tomorrow morning.
Great.
Thank you. So, just thought it would be
exciting.
A nice piece of information to be shared with you because it's such a positive experience for everybody.
It's wonderful.
The teachers here, I mean, you can see all the teachers involved. They volunteer. They're very excited to volunteer. They're wonderful mentors. They provide the students with everything that they need. They spend lots of time. They provide them with so much guidance. It's a beautiful mentoring relationship that develops as a result. And it's a beautiful relationship that's established also with the students.
the younger students.
And I'm sure the teachers are learning an awful lot.
Oh, they do. They do.
So the mentoring,
it's a two-way relationship.
Forth, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah, definitely.
Absolutely. Yeah.
That's
yes.
great.
And many of these same teachers have come forward for next year.
That's
also
positive. Good
yes.
stuff.
Yes. So.
That's great.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Christine. You're welcome.
Well done. I'll tell you, I was in districts when one of the benefits the colleges did was they actually came off-site and offered classes that the teachers would take, and therefore the price of those classes became dramatically reduced.
Isn't that nice?
So it was a nice...
Oh, maybe we should ask about that.
I would definitely... I got one of my masters that way because they...
Really nice.
It was cheap.
Right.
You don't have to pay facility fees.
Thank you.
Let's move on to the superintendent's report.
I have one just a piece of information that I want to share with you tonight. This is a position paper that the Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents has put out on the recreational use of marijuana, the initiative, the petition that's out there right now. And obviously the superintendents are taking a pretty strong stance on this, that we are not in favor of this. And I wanted you to have the position and know what superintendents are saying. And the data that really struck me is if you flip to the second page, the hospitalizations in Colorado related to marijuana have increased 82% since 2008. The year after the drug was legalized there, emergency room visits increased by 30%. So there's some pretty strong data that's in here. But we also feel that marijuana is another gateway drug. And given the fact that we have an opiate crisis, we are not in favor of this. So I just thought it was important that the school committee have a copy of this. So that's really all I had tonight, knowing that we had many other things on the agenda.
Can you offer one other piece? If the school committee is interested, there are two senators who put together a really solid report. They went to Europe and they went to Colorado and have sort of outlined all of, you know, in a really well-documented report about the issue, response, you know, and some of the concerns that were raised as a result of, they went, you know, fairly neutral and they came back, I understand, fairly negative in terms of some of the information that they brought back about this. So I have access to that report and would be happy to send it out to everyone if they would like to read it, because I think it's organized in a really good way about the ballot question and the kinds of things that the state will be faced with, you know, if and when this does pass. And they're, you know, so I would be happy to share that too. And
thank you.
We have this now from the superintendent, so. Thank you. Assistant Superintendent Beck.
We sent out 166 invitations to summer school to our students in grades 1 through 6 recently. And these are students who have been identified that could really benefit from some consistent instruction over the summer. And help build their confidence for entering the next grade level.
These aren't IEP students.
These are not, no. So that's, we're waiting to hear back from those families, and there's still an extended list beyond those. But
so these are students who have failed a class or who would benefit from?
These are students who would benefit. They're not students who have failed a class. Some of the students are students who have been receiving intervention during the school year. And we know we might be at a little bit of risk for some regression over the summer months, and so we'd like to keep up the consistency with their literacy work.
So this is summer program, not necessarily summer school, as it's traditionally known.
Right, it is. Yeah.
Okay.
Well,
like a summer enrichment more than a.
It is. Well, it's school. I mean, they
yeah,
come
I,
in there.
Do you know what I'm
taught.
Saying? Summer
and
school
I do
is
know.
A.
It's not a credit recovery.
It's credit recovery.
School.
Do we have?
Yeah.
Not like
that,
no.
So, actually, last year we started that at the middle school.
At the middle school.
At the middle school. We don't have, we collaborate on credit recovery at the high school level with other local high schools.
Okay.
So, But yeah, we did start some programming like that at the middle school last summer.
Who, is that a grant? Like, who teaches and pays for summer enrichment programs?
We pay through that through the local budget.
Huh.
It's part of the curriculum budget. It's okay. A line item. You'll see summer programs and line item in the curriculum budget.
And how many hours a day and how many weeks? And
This program this summer is going to run 6 weeks. And we run it in the morning 4 days a week.
Like 8 to 12?
Mm-hmm. Usually, I think it's 9 to noon or something like that.
No, it's just, I was just trying to figure out the number of hours.
Mm-hmm.
That's correct.
Mm-hmm.
That's good.
Mm-hmm.
So it's free of charge to the families?
It is. So, and the other thing we've been working pretty intensely on right now is developing our ELL programming for next year. That population is always changing and it's shifting, and we've just had 3 students exit our school district that are either moving to other communities or moving back home, but, you know, equal in numbers or more come in all the time. So we're just shifting. We're seeing where we're going to need the help. You know, you saw an increase in the ELL teacher for next year. We'll be adding an additional 0.5 for next year, which I think is going to balance things a little bit better than what we've had this year, and is going to help us accommodate our newcomer students, because we have more and more newcomers coming into the district, and those are students who enter the district speaking no English at all. So they require a lot of service in the course of a week. But progress so rapidly, it just amazes me. It really does.
Are they included? It's like is our ELL push in?
Mm-hmm.
Or do we have a program for them?
Well, they're included. They're not in a separate classroom all day long, but much of their service is pull out, particularly if they're a newcomer, because we're trying to get them to a point where they can function a little bit better
of course.
In the classroom. But so they get intensive intervention, but they're all included in the classroom setting. So they're all a part of the classroom.
So mixed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
My son didn't speak any English when he came, and it was pretty inclusive.
Yeah.
How
and
old Christine was he?
He came into kindergarten. He was
mm-hmm.
6, yeah.
It's wonderful. I mean, I'm so proud of the work that our ELL
mm-hmm.
teachers do. It's really cool. Quite remarkable when I see the way the students are progressing. You know, I'll meet a newcomer when they come in, and I'll go back and observe them a month later, and I hear the dialogue that they're having and what the reading that they're doing. And then I go back a month after that, and it's just the progress is so impressive with the students. So so those have been two focus areas the last week.
Just got a text from Lieutenant Governor. Wishing us luck on the school budget. We could have a lot of luck if we could have a little
right.
Right back to her. We're all in attention.
That's right.
Did we, and maybe this is a question for you, Susan, do we have any educatious students for next year yet?
We do not.
Because I noticed
Steve,
there was a zero.
Steve Jenkins, who is one of our liaisons, he keeps insisting that he has got students who are interested.
Well, we got a call today.
Oh, we did?
We got a call today.
Oh,
say so for one.
No, that's
so.
What is it?
The educators, the international
educators.
Students.
Yeah, it's for accepting international students who come on a tuition basis. So Mike got a call today from Steve.
Okay.
That he was returning this afternoon about a student. So
what,
across
what is the reimbursement?
We've upped our tuition to 18,600 per student.
It's something we want to pursue.
Mm-hmm.
It's good for the community too.
It's really good for the community.
The college student, not college student, but the senior from China who spoke the letter at the favorite poem project yesterday was charming.
Yeah.
She was from China.
I think I missed that.
Oh,
you were the MDC.
We had great students coming.
I don't know if I accepted, but I sent a poem.
Okay. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
No,
I'll add that to the list.
It's okay. Yes, we hope to be able to expand that. There, the state is also viewing international students and exchange students a little bit different than they used to as far as ELL goes.
Oh, okay.
Before, we weren't allowed to pick them up as an official ELL student.
No.
They didn't fit
criteria.
The criteria, but now that has changed, so now all of our international students need to be tested upon entry. And if they qualify, they become an ELL student. But our ELL teacher at the high school, when we had the education students the last time, saw all of them anyway. She said that just wouldn't be fair for them
no,
to come
of course
and not,
not
have some support. So she, you know, without picking them up on the official roster, she still met with them, and she included them in the group work that she was doing with the other ELL students, and that was really beneficial for them.
Good. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can I just make one?
Sure.
I just wanted to talk about the Literary Festival this weekend, and the Mr. Webb's seventh grade students did civics projects, history projects of Newburyport that were absolutely phenomenal. The trifold that they created are going to be up at City Hall again for the entire class, but a group of students volunteered to come and present on Saturday morning, and they were phenomenal. They were articulate. They talked about their primary and secondary sources, what they learned, what they studied, why, the people they interviewed, different places they went in the community. It was a phenomenal project. So, and I know that Glee Woodworth and others also helped. So thank you for making such a wonderful project, and be sure to head to City Hall on May 20th, I believe is the date for the full, the entire seventh grade presentation.
It's very impressive.
It
I
was
agree. Thank
very
you for
impressive.
Bring that up. Yeah, very good.
All right, let's move on because we do have an executive session this evening. Joint Education met previous to this meeting. We had two agenda items that we addressed. One was the budget, and the second was the need for more intervention at the Mullen School. We didn't get any further. The budget took up most of the time. So, finance, Paul, has any other subcommittee met since the last time we met? Okay. So that's it for the subcommittee reports. I would like to have an executive session this evening for the purpose of contract negotiations. We will not be coming back out into the public.
Second.
Oh, roll call. Roll call, please.
Cheryl.
I'm sorry.
Right, Nick.
Mr. Cole?
Yes.
Mr. DeCanta?
Yes.
Ms. Miller?
Yes.
And Ms. Abson. Mayor Holliday?
Yes.
Ms. Sweeney?
Yes.
Mr. Hawkeye?
Yes.
Could I have a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I have additional thoughts.